to Superintendent's Viewpoint for November 1986. Remember, this program is developed to help us explain issues that that we hear at board meeting in a more comprehensive, detailed manner. Today we have Jeff Conrad, our Business and Finance Director, to help us understand the most critical issue that we're facing today in Hazel Park Schools, the millage vote that's scheduled for December the 2nd. Mr. Gibson, our superintendent, will help us by explaining the proposal. Sometimes language on proposals, Mr. G, is hard for some of us to understand. Can you help us with the understanding of that language?
Yes, Russ. What we're essentially asking the voters on December 2nd is to transfer a mill from the debt millage. We presently levy 4 mills for debt, which is to pay off loans on the construction of buildings and so on over the years. We're asking to reduce that from 4 to 3 mills and increase the operating millage by 1 mill. And that would generate approximately $460,000 for the school district each year. And the nice thing about that would be we would have $270,000 come from Lansing to assist us in state aid. 1 mill generates about $190,000 in tax monies, mm-hmm. and the state would give us $270,000 in state aid to make it a sum total of $460,000. So that's the issue, really. It's a transfer from the debt millage to the operating millage, and the result is no tax increase. It's the same exact rate, 3904.
Okay. The language is going to say increase, isn't it?
It will, but the resolution of the board was to decrease the 1 mill, the debt mill, that we're presently levying.
So when we go in and use the voting booth, it is going to say increase on it, but by reducing the debt mill, it's
a transfer.
The same. Okay.
Yeah.
Even though it says increase on the ballot, it's
strictly a transfer. It's a wash, as they call it.
Okay. How are we able to reduce our debt mill that pays for our buildings and keeping them, I guess, some buildings that we still owe money on and some debts that we have. How are we able to reduce that, Jeff?
Well, first you have to realize, Russ, what, as you mentioned, what the debt millage is for. It's to pay off our bonds that we sold years ago to build our buildings. Over the years, some of these bonds, we've paid them all off, and we don't have those obligations anymore for some of our elementary schools. And we've also had some investment earnings on our investments from those debt retirement funds. And we've been able to use that money to pay off additional bonds. And we're in a pretty solvent position right now with a surplus in that fund. And we don't need the money for the next 4 or 5 years, or we don't need a 4 mil levy anyway for the next 4 or 5 years. And we feel a 3 mil levy in the debt fund will be able to help us meet our obligations as far as the debt millage goes. And that's how we can do that.
Jeff, why can't we just take that money and move it over and use it? Why do we have to go to an election?
Well, there's two separate funds, the debt retirement fund that we're talking about reducing the millage in, and the operating fund. And by law, they have to be separate, and you can't commingle those funds. So what we have to do is actually have a, since we want to increase the general operating, we actually have to have a vote of the people to increase that general operating millage. And as a separate issue, we can look at the debt retirement millage, and we want to decrease that. Since the school board can reduce the millage without a vote, that part of it won't be voted on. The school board's already done that. They voted to decrease that debt millage at the September board meeting, I believe, September or October board meeting. So that half of it's been taken care of, and now we just need the people's approval to increase the operating millage.
Okay, so the law keeps us from taking that money from the debt retirement and using it over here to buy supplies and things like that.
That's correct. When we sold the bonds, we We told the people that's what the money was going to be used for, and that's what it has to be used for.
And that's what the law says?
That's right.
Okay. How did we ever get into such a deficit? I mean, we for the past several years, we've had continued deficit. How do we get ourselves into this situation?
Okay, the good question. The reason why we're asking for this Operation Millage is because of the fact our expenditures are exceeding our revenues by about $460,000, just about what this mill would generate. And we're into the deficit mode right now for a couple of reasons, and I'd like Jeff really to explain that for us, but there are a couple of reasons for that.
Well, we faced the same operating cost increases that you or I as individuals have. Number one, our utility bills have gone up over $1 million now a year. Our liability insurance, all governmental units recently have been faced with steep increases in liability insurance, and we certainly weren't exempt from that.
Mm-hmm.
So we've been facing the same cost increases as other businesses and as you and I as individuals have been faced with over the past few years. We've also had a reduction in a declining pupil enrollments. And the way the state aid formula is computed, for the school district of Hazel Park, we get about $3,000 per pupil. And as we start losing pupils, we start losing $3,000 per pupil. We've had a decline in enrollments of a couple hundred in the past year, and that comes to $600,000 loss in revenue for the school district. It's hard to make up those losses. It's in revenue, and that quick of and that short of a notice, we find out that we've lost 200 pupils sometime in October on the fourth Friday count.
Right.
And we've already started the year. We've have projections on what the enrollment is going to be, and you know, we were off by 200 pupils. In the prior years, we were fairly close. What we didn't anticipate was a large reduction in adult education enrollments. The competition for adult ed students has increased. As you probably noticed in your own mailbox, you get brochures from several of the school districts in the area. And at one time, we were, as Hazel Park, we were the only ones doing that. And
right.
And so the increased competition for those programs have really reduced our enrollments in adult education. Also, during times when the economy is going good, there's a tendency for people to be at work, and they're not in the adult education program. And so we lost quite a few in adult ed enrollments, as I mentioned. And that took a big bite out of our revenues. And to offset that, over the past 2 years, we've made cuts in staff. We've cut over $1.3 million out of our teaching staff, custodial staff, secretarial staff, administrative staff. We've cut it down to what we think is down past the fat. We're down to the meat now, and we don't think we can cut it anymore without really affecting our programs.
And that's been kind of an important ingredient, hasn't it, Jim, that you've maintained that we didn't want to cut where we have to really disrupt programs.
Right.
We haven't lost any programs.
No, in fact, as Jeff pointed out, we've cut $1,300,000 in annual expenses over the last 2 years, and we haven't cut out any programs. Now, we've reduced some in size,
mm-hmm.
and we're not doing as much as we'd like to do, nor as much as we used to do, but we're trying to get back within our means. One of the things that I'm proud of as a citizen, as a community, and as an employee of this district is the fact that we run a very efficient operation here. In the Oakland Schools annual report that came out here recently, of the 28 school districts in Oakland County, we have I think it was what, Jeff, the amount of money behind each child that we spend, $2,900, which is, there are only four districts in Oakland County that spend less per child than Hazel Park. So I think what Jeff is saying is absolutely correct. We're running a very, very tight ship, and we're running close to the chest. I might also add that we have been working at the same tax rate since 1978. There has not been an increase in our operating millage. And some of the things that we've prepared in our efforts to communicate with the public shows some tremendous increases in costs. Again, I'm trying to think, Jeff, on like heat, from what, 78 to the present time, what would, he has four or five things that maybe we should touch on, just to show you the growth and the expansion in crisis. And what
we're those of us that have houses and pay heat and electric know that things have really gone up. I was astounded by the figures, Jeff.
Yeah, the heat's gone from around $200,000 to over $350,000 in just the past few years. Likewise, the light for our electricity bill has gone from about $175,000 to over $360,000. Our telephone bills almost doubled from $40,000 to $95,000. Some of the things that people don't think about is or don't have in their home, but textbooks 10 years ago were costing us $5-6 a book. Now they're running between $16 and $25 a book. Workbooks. They used to be $1, $1.50 for these small disposable type of workbooks that they use 1 year. Now they're running between $3 and $6 a piece. The costs have gone up.
Significant cost increases.
So to wrap it up on the question that Jeff was asked, how did we get to the position where we're $400,000 or anticipating a $400,000 deficit? The truth is that the prices and expenses have gone up. We've been at the same rate. We haven't had a tax increase since 1978. And in addition to that, we are experiencing, as many districts in the area, declining enrollments. And for every youngster that leaves the Hazel Park schools, we experience a $3,000 loss in state aid. And those combined created the situation we're faced with. We need to generate more revenue, and this is an almost painless way to do it.
For sure. The natural question that comes out of that is that as your students reduce, you reduce staff. But I guess the logical response that I've heard time and time again is that those kids go maybe one from Ford and a couple from United Oaks, and they go from all around. And you just can't reduce staff and maintain kids in local school programs.
That's right.
Isn't that right?
You just can't cut at the same rate. If we lose 200 youngsters and they all left kindergarten, that would be simple. You would just eliminate X amount of kindergartens. Mm-hmm. That doesn't happen, as you all know.
That's right. Okay, so if I understand the millage proposal and what it would be like taking some money that I have here, moving it over to here where we can use it on a regular basis, where we can continue to buy textbooks and provide quality education for our kids. And then the state would kick in another $270,000 because we now have that on an operating millage kind of situation.
Right, so moving it from debt to operation, that's what we're asking people to do. If people say yes, no tax increase, it will require Lansing to send us $270,000 a year to help in the operation of these schools. And we just can't afford not to take advantage of that. We need the money.
That sounds like a good deal to me. Sounds like we're hoping that on December the 2nd, you avail yourself of the opportunity to vote. Please get out and support your good schools. Now, in other developments, we have a new staff member, too, right, Mr. G?
Right.
Okay, let's talk to him.
Okay.
By unanimous vote of the Board of Education last night, Lauren Bletcher was named as Director of Curriculum. Congratulations, Lauren.
Well, thank you.
In a continuing effort to reduce expenses also, the job of Assistant Superintendent, which really had as curriculum underneath it, was eliminated from the school district last night, and the new position was created as director of curriculum, which Lauren has. Knowing that this is maybe the first time you've been on this program, Lauren, maybe you could help some of us that don't know you very well and explain, where have you been in Hazel Park?
Sure. I started out in Hazel Park in 1975 at the high school as the assistant principal. And from that, have done some things at the junior high and high school in times of going from ninth grade to 10th grade. That seemed to be a natural scheduling and coordination of the programs. And then later on in life here in Hazel Park, got involved with Dr. Newberry on some projects. The last couple of years, I've been serving as a district-wide test coordinator. I had some responsibilities for the MEAP program. And then,
what is MEAP, Lauren?
Michigan Educational Assessment Program.
Okay, that's a state test.
That's a state test that's given to 4th, 7th, and 10th graders.
Okay.
And then in Dave's illness, kind of picked up some of the responsibilities at the start of school with some grants and some applications for some money from state and federal programs. So that's kind of a one-minute synopsis of what I've been doing for 11 years.
Okay.
What did you do before you came to Hazel Park?
Well, I had a kind of a hopscotch career. I started out as a science teacher. I filled in at the very end of my student teaching experience over in South Redford at Thurston High School for a gentleman by the name of Marv Smith. From there, I taught for 2 years at Madison Heights, just up the road, 11 mm-hmm. Mile, John R. And then a new high school opened up in Bloomfield Hills called Losser High School. And there was some excitement about being a new staff member in a brand new building, and kind of tradition begins with us. And I went there and worked with them in some continuous progress curriculum. Got involved as a science objective writer, state science test item writer. Was involved at the state board level with the task force to revise the Common Goals of Michigan. Was a task force chairman. Got involved with State Principals Association and some curriculum and interface groups that way. Mm-hmm. So lots of different experiences coming to us.
Where did you get your undergraduate work and graduate work? What college, university?
Sure. I was a Redford High School graduate, and from there I went to Michigan State University. And at Michigan State I was a graduate with a degree in chemistry, and went back and took some additional courses to teach. I found industry to be lonesome. It was fun, but I was the only one in the lab, where it was myself and the head chemist, so I missed the people. And at the end of a summer experience, came back to the university and went to a counselor and said, I really like chemistry, but I miss people. And that's kind of what started me to be a chemistry teacher. While I was at Madison Heights, I got involved with what was then called Harvard Physics Project, and that took me down to Wayne State University. And from there, I became my master's degree, which was in instructional technology and curriculum design. And I had this idea at one time that you could lay out the perfect pieces of curriculum so that students wouldn't make any mistakes, that they could just go through if you had all the right pieces together. And that was what my master's program was like. And then I had a chance to pilot that at local schools in the Tri-County area, and got some recognition and a chance to do some things with student teachers when Wayne State was first starting its phase or Dyke program, you know, part of a student teacher training manual. That's kind of where I became enthralled with the fact that teaching's not only the mechanics, but there's an art form to it, that there's something greater than just all the steps in the curriculum. It's the human interactions, the social dynamics. And that kind of led me to a master's degree and post-master's work in a specialist in educational administration.
Nice.
And that was also done at Wayne State.
Okay, where do you see us going? You're new and you get a chance to have some direction. Can you kind of tell us, maybe, and break it down? Can you break it down by elementary, second and secondary, maybe junior high, senior high, areas that you think we should be working on, or maybe a more global plan right now, Lauren?
This is a new kid on the block, so can I come back a year from now and change my mind?
Sure.
I think if you look at it right now, from the stuff that I've been able to glean from the testing side of the job, that we have a lot of things in place, from Head Start and child care and developmental programs and early identification, that kindergarten through third grade, we really seem to have a lot of things in place and working. And it looks to me like there is a lot of things happening fourth, fifth, and sixth grade. There's already curriculum. The problem is that we're not talking to one another enough. We're not coordinating. So if I'm going to serve as a role model there, it's going to be to help people talk to one another, and some good things are working here and some good things are working here, and getting them to share and communicate. I don't see that there's a lot of time and we can put something in the curriculum without taking something out. So at 4, 5, 6 level, I see it more of a articulation and coordination and directing in the sense of helping and making people in connection with people, how they're, who's doing things here and there. When we go from 8 elementaries to 2 junior high schools, you just can't help it. That's 8 elementaries. In some cases, it's almost 16 different 6th grades. The 7th grades, there's just not the bridge that's happening. So I see a potential there to do something so that the 6th grade to 7th grade transitions a little less hectic, maybe, a little less chaotic, and would like to help in that way. I'd like to see something more in terms of our enrichment or challenge or gifted, or I don't really know what words to call for it. I kind of call them the blue dot kids, the real gems. What can we do to provide them some experiences? We've got a nice Super Saturday program for some kids that have some interest. How do we carry that 7th grade through 12th grade? How do we not lose those youngsters? Get them involved, keep them involved. So that's kind of a...
Our Super Saturday program is primarily elementary.
Yeah, primarily services elementary. And at the high school level, I've been involved with those students as 11th and 12th graders. And we do things in terms of mentorships and independent studies. We do some things where we have, where we couldn't provide them the instruction in town, and so we try to provide them some other ways of getting that instruction through community college or through someone in industry coming in and doing some things with them. I don't know what happens, really, 6th grade to 9th grade, so I'm eager to find out what's going on there and what can I do to facilitate it and keep it going.
Okay. Well, sounds like you have some ambitious plan.
Right. Let's hope they work.
Okay, we will. You know, you mentioned someone going to Oakland Community College. Some of the information I read on one of the Student of the Month.
Dave Byers.
Yeah, he was planning on going to Oakland Community College. So let's to bring Student of the Month on and talk to those kids and see what's been happening. They look really good to me.
Right.
This portion of Superintendent's Viewpoint allows us the opportunity to meet three of the outstanding students at our secondary schools. We have Ronald Thompson from Beecher Junior High School as Student of the Month. Hi, Ron.
Hi.
Glad you could make it.
Good to be here.
Good. How long have you gone to Hazel Park Schools, Ron?
All my life.
Where did you go to elementary school?
United Oaks.
All the time?
Mm-hmm.
Only one elementary school? I always ask if you have a favorite teacher at the elementary school, someone who made big impact on you.
Yeah, I had Miss Gibson.
Really?
It was my favorite teacher.
That's a good choice, Ron.
Yeah, big impact on me too, Ron.
What do you remember most about Mrs. Gibson and her teaching?
I don't know. She just explained things better than some teachers. And she controlled her class very well.
Well, weren't kids jumping up and around and making a disturbance? And you notice how well behaved Mr. Gibson is.
And Ron knows why.
Okay, now you're a ninth grader at Beecher.
Mm-hmm.
What are some of the things that you've done at Beecher Junior High School besides go to class?
Well, I've been in the cross country team for the past 3 years. And I joined basketball this year. I've been in band, the solo ensemble, and we went to festival, band festival.
What's a band festival, and when did you go?
Last February, last year. And we play 2 songs, and the judge judges us and gives us a 1, 2, or 3. And we got a 1.
Is 1 the best?
Yeah.
Okay. And those are songs that you've never seen before, or do you have to sight read those?
Well, there's 2 that we practice at school, and then we go and play. And they have us sight read one of theirs.
That's tough, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
Never seen it before. Mm-hmm. And you have to play the right notes, right?
Yeah.
And that means everybody. How many do you have in the band that goes to this kind?
I don't really know. It's quite
15,
a few.
20, 30, 40?
Maybe 40.
Wow.
No.
And when you get those songs, everybody has to play the right thing at the right
time.
That's tough.
Yeah. They give us a couple of minutes for Mr. Gebhardt to explain some of the hard points mm-hmm. of the music.
That makes sense to me.
Ron, we notice you're an honor roll student. Have you always been an AV student?
Yeah, usually, mm-hmm. unless something happens.
Do you do a lot of homework, or does it come pretty easy for you?
It comes pretty easy for some reason. I don't know why.
You must be pretty smart.
Just be happy about that. There will be a time, probably, when you have to work harder. I see you you have a goal of going to the University of Michigan.
Yeah, one of the reasons is the band went to the University of Michigan last year, I think, and I saw the campus and the band, and it's really nice.
It's impressive, that Michigan mm-hmm. band, isn't it?
They look really good, don't they?
Yeah.
Would you be interested in being the marching band that you have?
Yeah, yes, I would.
What are your goals for yourself, Ron?
Well, I haven't really set many goals, but I think I just would like, maybe when I go to college, study criminal law or any type of law.
Mm-hmm. So then become a lawyer.
Yeah.
All right.
That's a good goal. You can come back and keep us out of trouble.
Yeah.
Okay. Appreciate very much you stopping by, Ron. Good luck to you.
Thanks.
Great. Okay, our second student comes from of the month comes from Webb Junior High School, and it's Deanna Perrault, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Deanna, how long have you gone to Hazel Park School?
All my life.
The entire time?
Uh-huh.
Where'd you go to elementary school?
Addison's.
As I asked Ron before you, did you have a favorite teacher at Addison School?
Yeah, my second grade teacher, Mrs. Stern.
Mrs. Stern. Why do you remember Mrs. Stern?
I don't know. I liked her. I don't know. She was just really sweet.
She's kind of a fun class.
Yeah.
She's an upbeat lady, isn't she?
Uh-huh.
I've been to her class several times, and it always seems kind of upbeat. Kids work hard, but they seem to have a good time while they learn.
Uh-huh.
Is that what happened to you?
Yep.
I'm glad. Then you're in the ninth grade at Webb Junior mm-hmm. High School? What kind of things are you doing at Webb Junior High School that makes school interesting for you?
I'm on the swim team. And I was a captain last year. And I play the clarinet in symphonic band. I am on student council.
Wow. Do lots of extracurricular things then, huh?
Yeah.
Okay. What do you swim?
Breaststroke.
That's pretty hard to do, isn't it? You have a brother that's a swimmer, don't you?
Uh-huh.
Doesn't he do breaststroke also?
Yeah, he graduated this year,
oh,
so.
He does. Does it run in the family?
Yeah, I guess so.
Breaststroking? And you're in the band.
Mm-hmm.
How long have you been playing the clarinet?
Since fifth grade.
You also notice you're an honor roll student.
Yeah.
Do you have a lot of homework? Do you study a lot of homework?
A lot of studying.
Mm-hmm. And we see that you too are looking for college and
uh-huh.
the University of Michigan?
Yep.
How come the University of Michigan?
I heard it had a good dental school, and since I want to be an orthodontist, then go there.
What made you want to be an orthodontist?
I really don't know. I had braces once, and
I was wondering if you did.
Yeah.
She has such beautiful teeth, doesn't she?
Well, they did a good job, right?
Yeah. Sure.
And you want to inflict that pain on other people, is that what it is?
Yeah.
Oh,
come on.
Oh, that's just awful, isn't it, when you have all the apparatus on?
Yeah.
Yeah, it does make it hard, and you have all those eating problems and things like that.
Yeah.
I remember.
But necessary and worth it, right?
Yeah.
When you look at the end product.
The coming back to Webb School, do you like Webb Junior High School?
Mm-hmm.
And you're looking forward to going to the high school?
Yeah.
Are you nervous about that?
Not really. It's another school.
know, with a brother going through, you have an idea kind of what to expect.
Yeah.
And you think you're going to like what you're going to have at the high school?
Uh-huh.
I bet you will.
Tell me about the essay contest. You entered the essay contest?
Uh-huh.
And who sponsored the contest? Do you remember?
I'm not real sure. I think it was the veterans.
Mm-hmm. And they had a competition, mm-hmm. right?
Yeah, I'm sure that's right.
And you placed third?
Uh-huh.
Who helped you write the essay?
I did.
Yeah, all by yourself, huh?
Yeah.
That's really very good. Well, we're really glad to have you as part of our school district. We really are.
Thank you.
Good luck to you when you go on to the high school. Good luck to you in swim season this year.
Thanks.
Okay. Thanks for stopping by. Student of the month from the high school is David Byers. Hi, David.
Hi.
Glad you could stop by. We were just talking before the camera came on about David's busy schedule. You do have a busy schedule, don't you?
Yes.
Kind of summarize for us the kind of schedule that you maintain, okay?
Well, on Mondays, I go to school till 11:30. Then at 1 to 3, I'll be at OCC. After that, I go straight to swimming practice. After swimming practice, I'll go home and eat, and then I'll go back to work until 9 or so.
So that the people out there, Russ, understand what he's talking about with OCC.
Mm-hmm.
That's Oakland Community College. What would you be doing at Oakland Community College during the day when you should be in school?
Well, I'm taking 4 credit hours of Calculus 1 there.
Now back, you know, a few meetings ago, one of our board members raised that question about, you know, do we have students that actually take part in that program? And Dave's one of the first ones to actually do that. How do you like going to a community college?
It's nice. It's a lot harder than high school calculus or any of the other high school classes, but it's not too bad.
And are you comfortable there as far as with the other students?
Yeah, it's really, if you fit right in to it.
It's good to know.
College is kind of a different environment. They just kind of take you for granted, don't they?
Yeah, you're there and that's it.
And you have to discipline yourself to do the work, right?
Yeah.
Because no one encourages you very much.
The homework isn't required, but you have to do it or else you won't do very well on the tests.
Mm-hmm. When do you find time to study, David?
Usually at night. Or 2 days a week I'll have the afternoons off where I have a chance to study. Or else I'll do it after I get off work.
How many hours a week do you work?
Approximately 25.
Wow, and a full-time student.
Yeah.
That's impressive.
And a full-time athlete.
That's right, I forgot about his athletics.
Swimming takes an awful lot of time and energy, doesn't it?
Yes, about starting next week it'll be 4 or 5 hours a day.
I was noticing last night too, Russ, that Dave's captain of 3 athletic teams at the high school.
Yeah.
That hasn't happened very often in our history over there, I don't think.
I don't think it happens too much.
No. So you're captain of the golf team?
Yeah.
The swim team and the tennis team?
Yes.
I was really impressed with your average golf score. Did I remember that correctly? What is your...
38.
That's your average golf score. What's the best round you've ever shot?
Pretty much it's about a 32 I shot once.
What was par?
Well, the best score was a 32. My best over par was an even par round of 36.
Okay.
Once.
So you shot an even?
Yeah.
Well, that's incredible. How did you develop the interest in golf?
My dad started golfing about 6 years ago, and when I was in 8th grade, I decided that I wanted to try it, and I've pretty much been playing since.
Now, is Dad a good golfer also?
I'm better than him.
Oh, you're better than a lot of people. You're better than I am, too.
That's right.
And I work at it.
Better than most people I know, David, that's for sure.
It's kind of, excuse me, I just want to pick up one other thing on the golf. Hazel Park this year had just an incredible year. They were 10-1, and you'd only lost one match in the league, the SMA. A few years ago, we started golf in Hazel Park. And many people said, well, you don't belong.
you know, Hazel Park doesn't belong with the Andovers and the Sea Homes and, you know, these places where youngsters are in country clubs mm-hmm. at an early age and have professional, you know, help and so on. And it just tickled me. I was watching that progress this year, and you beat all of them but Sea Home.
Yeah, our last meet of the year we lost.
So I bet you raised some eyebrows in that league when your team came through. Good team.
Yeah, it was.
Very nice team.
What are your plans for the future, David?
Well, I'm applying to, I've already applied to Michigan State University, and I'll be applying today to the University of Michigan. And I'd like to go into chemical engineering at either of the schools.
Okay. Yeah, you can play athletics at the
Well, I'd like to try out for it and see how far I get.
I would think the way you shoot golf, you ought to be on the golf team.
Hopefully.
Okay.
National Honor Society, I see, too.
Yeah.
So it's just all around, isn't it?
It certainly is all around.
Pretty proud of you.
Well, sorry to take you away from your classes. We better let you go so you get back, okay?
Okay.
Thanks very much for stopping by.
Thank you.
There you have another superintendent's viewpoint for November 1986. We've had a good opportunity to review with Mr. Conrad and Mr. Gibson the demillage issue, and we've met three outstanding secondary students. Thank you very much for watching.